good to be in the presence of the Lord? Oh, heaven invade. Yes, I am so thankful to be here tonight. I'm so thankful that each of you are here. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I have the distinct privilege of introducing someone who is absolutely precious to me, not just to me, but to everyone across this entire world. Our superintendent's wife is here with us, and this is her district. She is at home. One of her mottos is change is good. Change is good. I'm so thankful to be loved, to be prayed for by Mama B. I could not thank her enough. I know she doesn't want me to say any more, but she is Nana to six, and she's also Mama to six, and Mama B to a bunch of us. So I love you, my pastor's wife, my friend.
Very sweet. I've gotten to where I'll come up and just steal the mic, so you may be seated. This is one of my favorite places to be. I love my Texas South Central Ladies Conference ladies. And it's so good to see all of you. And wow, look around. This is a fantastic crowd. This is great. So good to be here and been going nonstop all over everywhere. And sometimes I wake up in the morning. You ever had those moments you think, okay, where am I? And what am I supposed to be doing? And what town am I in? And is Brother Bernard with me? I'm so thankful to have my mom with me tonight. Just wave. She is and has been a godly example of his beauty and grace all of my life. And I love you dearly. The only real big argument, not really even a big argument, but disagreement we had was over Brother Bernard. Because she loved him and I did not like him for a long time. But I'm glad to have you as my road warrior partner. And I'm thankful to have her with me. Wow, I tell you, this is a great place. And I know some of you are probably saying, oh, but I miss Embassy Suites. Well, it was in my notes, Sister Cassie Huslidge. Change is good. It's good to get out of the rut. It's good to be somewhere new and somewhere different. And it gives an opportunity to ladies come that may not be able to get that far. We still are a big district. Anybody want to say amen? Amen. Okay, take a deep breath. Everybody, all right, put your arms up real high. If you know me, I'm a practical. Stretch them really good. Now, don't hurt yourself. Stretch. Oh, doesn't that feel good? Feels good. You know, I love to hear when we have themes, and I love this theme. Beautifully rooted, rooted and grounded. Ladies, he is with us. If you have any doubt that he goes with you, you need to just stop that right now. You know, you're going to hear some amazing things, and you've probably heard, I've just kind of seen and heard some rumors that you heard just amazing word this morning, this afternoon, and it sounds like Ginger just knocked it out of the park, and it's good to see her. And but, you know, you have to always be intentional when it's with life, really, but especially with God. He's a gentleman. He will not force his way into your heart and into your life. So hopefully, if you haven't already, you give him permission to work on you. And if you walk away and you say, I just really didn't get what I wanted. Well, guess whose fault it is? You are here and you're going to continually hear some amazing things. Let God work on you. You know, oh, I don't want to go there. Go there. Okay, you're at a place where God is ready to work on you. I want him to work on me. I want him to always work on me. Anybody else feel that way? Amen. But can I just tell you, you know, talking about beautifully rooted, and I'm not going to be here long, but doubt will undermine your foundation, your rooting, your grounding. Fear will weaken your foundation, your rooting, and your grounding. Ladies, if it's a fire, we will get out of here very fast, so just don't worry. If you hear fire, then we will do it in an orderly manner. I just had to say that. So what do I say to you tonight? Talking about foundation and being rooted. Okay, look at your neighbor and do like this. And say, stop it. Oh, y'all did that really good. Y'all have said that before. Look at your other neighbor and say, you stop it too. Just stop it. Stop the fear mongering. Stop the doubt mongering. He is for you. He's got you. Trust him. Amen. I feel him in this place. Let's worship him right now. God, I thank you. You have enveloped this place with your presence. I thank you for what you're bringing in here. It's just the overflow from this afternoon, I know, but oh, catch that wave. When you feel it coming, don't just let it pass you by and say, oh, thank you, Jesus. Ooh, grab that way. You want to take that home with you. When you're weary and discouraged, that's where you say, I'm going to grab what I felt that night, that day. I just want to share one passage of scripture with you. You want to try to find it. I'm going to go all over with translations, so good luck with following me. And I make it personal, but I just really felt in reading the word and praying, and I thought, you know what, just a simple greeting. I wanted to leave you some word tonight. And just an encouragement that he's got you. And you, if you're worried about your rooting and your grounding and your foundation, then dig in this next day or two. Psalm 91, when I dwell in the secret place of the Most High, I will abide under the shadow of the Almighty, or Shaddai's shadow. I will say of the Lord God, you are my refuge and my fortress. My God, in you I will trust. You make me safe. Surely you will deliver me from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence, the hidden traps. You will cover me with your feathers. And under your wings will I take refuge. Your truth shall be my shield and my buckler. Your arms fend off all harm. I will not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday, or the disaster that erupts at high noon at my office when chaos just takes over. 1,000 may fall at my side and 10,000 at my right hand, even though others succumb all around, drop like flies right and left. No harm will even graze me. I will stand untouched. I will watch it all from a distance. I will watch the reward of the wicked. Yes, because God is my refuge. Say, God is my refuge. The high God is my very own home. Evil can't get close to me. Harm can't get through the door. You ordered your angels to guard me wherever I go. If I stumble, they will catch me. Their job is to keep me from falling. I will walk unharmed among lions and snakes, evildoers, gossipers. Does that sound familiar? And kick young lions and serpents from the path, because I have set my love upon you. Therefore, you will deliver me. You will set me on high because you know my name. Does he know your name? Of course he does. I will call upon you and you will answer me. You, my most high God, will be with me in trouble. You need to make the word personal. You will deliver me and honor me. With long life, you will satisfy me and show me your salvation. If I hold on to you for dear life, says God, you will get me out of trouble. You will give me the best of care if only I get to know and trust you. Call me, he says, and he will answer. Yes, God, you will be at my side in bad times. You will rescue me, then you will throw me a party. You will give me a long life, and you will give me a long drink of salvation. Wow. He loves us. He cares for us. We are beautifully rooted. We are beautifully founded. We are beautifully grounded. We are his daughters, ladies. Nothing should shake your foundation. I'm so glad. I just wanted to share that with you. You need to make the word personal to you. You find a scripture, put your name in there. Put my in there and me and you, God, are my most high God. Could I just have all the ministers' wives and pastors' wives stand just briefly? In praying this morning, I was in my closet, in the floor, and just really seeking God just for lots of things going on. And I felt something, and I felt him tell me, you need to tell these ladies. Ladies, all you other saints, ladies, wonderful ladies that are here, you're surrounded with these beautiful ministers' wives and pastors' wives that pray for you, that intercede for you. Ladies, can I tell you, the Lord told me to tell you, you are enough. He's given you what you need to do the job that he's called you to do. You are enough. And you are able to do what he's called you to do because you are enough. And he gave you everything that you need to accomplish what he has called you to do. I love all of you. You may be seated. I love all you. I'm so glad to be with you this evening.
What a delight. What an honor to have Sister Bernard with us. Are you thankful? Woo, I am. I am thankful to have my pastor's wife here. Well, the next individual I get the privilege to introduce is actually our district secretary's wife. Now, Gina Carruthers and her husband, David, pastor Calvary Church in San Antonio, Texas. Yes, they do. She is the founder of Following Titus II Ministries. Very acclaimed women teaching women. Throughout the years, her passion for ladies ministry has led her to the Following Titus II ministry mission, encouraging women to be in God's word daily. Daily. Behind the four walls of her glass house, she's known as Yaya, and she has been known to make up the silliest songs and laugh at ridiculous five-year-old jokes with her four grandchildren. Gina's love for others and keeping life real is inherent as the warming rays of the summer sun. The Carruthers tribe has been built on four strong family values. I loved this. Hard work, integrity, generosity, and making memories. Gina loves to travel, hike, sew, craft, make memories, be spontaneous, and live life to the fullest. Gina is my friend, and I am so grateful. I love you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sister Cassie. My goodness, my voice is strong. It is an honor to be here tonight, and I am given the beautiful task of introducing my husband. And I give honor to our First Lady tonight, Sister Bernard. I love you very much. Thank you for that word of the Lord. I'm glad God gave us a word from him already, because what I'm about to say is very carnal. And if you want something spiritual, go buy my Bible studies, because what I'm going to tell right now just is going to be a unique introduction to my husband. So I just needed to give you a little glimpse into our life of real ministry. It is our honor to serve the South Central Texas District. We love our district and are honored to serve with Brother and Sister Scoggins. What a joy. I love y'all. I love you, Sister Scoggins. Such a joy to serve with them, and I mean that from my heart. I wonder sometime if our little grandson, Jack, doesn't love Brother Scoggins almost as much as he loves his chief. But Anyway, so as we were doing our work for the Lord, I'm so thankful God gave me a husband that has strong integrity. He has a strong foundation on the Word of God, and he is led by the Spirit. He's trustworthy. And along with all those characteristics, God has also given him the blessing of being a CPA. And sometimes I love that, but most of the time, the only thing I love about it is the additional money it gives us for vacation. But anyway, getting back to this real quick. So I was told this is pre-service stuff. I don't know why y'all are still standing, because it's going to be a minute or two. Okay. So anyway, let me tell you. So we were serving our district, and we were out at a south, we were in Del Rio. How many, anybody here from Del Rio? All right. Okay, we were out there at Del Rio doing a sectional. They really are going to go sit down. They were in Del Rio doing a sectional conference. We were, and the Scoggins were with us. We were all there. And on our way home, my husband got in the truck, and he said, we were just about to get on the road, and he said, oh, Gina, I have such a bad headache. He said, I feel like I'm getting a migraine. He said, he said, do you have any Motrin? And I said, yeah, I think I do. So I pulled out my purse and started digging through my purse for Motrin. And I find this little glass vial in my purse that has little brown pills in it. And I said, here, do you want two or three or four? And he said, Gina, are you sure that those are Motrin? I said, yes, David, they're Motrin. And that, you know, that auditing spirit just came all over him. Needed to audit the situation right then and there. And I'm like, honey, they are Motrin. And he's like, I don't know. I'm not sure about that. He pulls over. Y'all, I've been married to this man 40 years. He pulls over to the side of the road and starts digging through his briefcase. Now, I want to tell you, this man, if you want to travel with somebody that needs, if you need a safety pin, if you, almost anything except, lady products, he's going to have it in his briefcase for you. He is alive. I love traveling with him. So anyway, he gets out of the truck. And I mean, we were going like 60 miles. He pulls over, gets out of the truck, starts digging through his little briefcase, looking for his Motrin. And I get my phone out because I'm going to get a pill identifier and show him that these are Motrin. And he should take my three or four Motrin to take care of his migraine. I get my pill identifier out. He's looking through his briefcase for his Motrin. He gets back in the car, and he found his Motrin, and he puts them in his mouth, and I said, oh, honey, I'm so glad you didn't take these pills. He looked at me, and he said, Gina, what are they? I said, they're stool softeners. I thanked God for that auditing spirit. I want to introduce to you our district, South Central Texas Secretary, Reverend David Carruthers.
I want to say thank you. Gina is a treasure of joy that continually unfolds and wraps our life with pleasantness of love and peace. We have lots of smiles and laughs. I'm going to take less time than she did. I'm blessed to be with you today. Thank you for this opportunity to take just a moment. And on behalf of the South Central Texas District leadership, all of them, I want to thank all of you ladies for being here, taking the time, the opportunity, days off, whatever you needed to do to get here. Thank you so much for joining with us to celebrate, worship God, and receive from God together. Thank you so much. And our special guest and our speakers, and of course, Sister Bernard, Sister Scoggins, we honor you. We're blessed that you are here, and thank you for being here. To the staff, to the ladies ministry team, thank you for working so hard. I just want to express it from the district leadership. Thank you, thank you, thank you for doing all the things you have done to make this successful already. We appreciate that very much, and we want you to know that. And of course, Sister Sanchez, our ladies secretary, Sister Huslidge, our ladies president, what an awesome job they do. And we are blessed. And I just want to take a moment to say thank you to all of you for being here. Thank you so much. And receive that from us. I'm not going to preach, but I am supposed to pray. So I'm going to ask you to stand with me. Let's pray together as we continue to worship God together. Lord, we are grateful for your grace, for your power, for you meeting with us here. Lord, we want to thank you for each one of these precious ladies that reflect your glory in their heart and with their lives. I pray, God, that you will continue to bless and anoint every singer, every musician, every speaker, every worshiper. Lord, let everything that is done give glory and honor and praise to your name. Lord, we pray that your felt presence and your wonder and your majesty would fill this place, that every heart would be filled with a glorious and astounding and a life-changing moment with you during this time together. In Jesus' name, we pray that these ladies would rise from their bended knees of prayer and with God-given power face every challenge they have. We pray that their roots would grow deeper and stronger, and they would tap into your enriching grace. Lord, that they will absorb every bit of your presence, every breath of your presence in this house, and be propelled to heights they have never achieved before. That each one of them would leave this place in the same manner, the same passion, the same fervor of those who left the upper room after your spirit was poured out on that first day of Pentecost. And let them go from house to house and from person to person and proclaim the gospel with signs following. And I pray that they would return in 2024 with new friends that have been filled with the Holy Ghost and baptized in Jesus' name. And Lord, we lift our hearts, we lift our faces, we lift our hands to give you glory and honor and praise and adoration in all that we do. Would you do that right now? Lift your voice to God and give him adoration and thanksgiving in Jesus' name.
Just of God, born of his spirit. Oh, I'm washed in his blood.
Freedom now,
because you have brought me out.
You have brought me out.
our God, the spotless Lamb, King of kings, the great I Am, He who was and is to come, Son of God, the Holy One, who are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. You're the flood that washes over, You're the fire that burns within. Everybody say,
to God be the glory forever. Unto God be the glory forever. Unto God be the glory forever. Unto God be the glory forever.
Oh, every heart, you are transforming. Come, have your glory. Darkness trembles, mountains crumble. When we draw near to us, you draw near to us. Strongholds breaking, destinies changing. When you draw near to us, you draw near to us.
Every life.
pray that he fills every one of your empty places in your life. Woo! You just got through singing, fill the room. What you meant it was, fill the emptiness and the void that this world has left inside of me. Fill it, Jesus. Fill it. Yes. Plant inside of me your spirit. Woo! All I gotta say today is amazing worship. Thank you so much. I am here to introduce our next speaker. But before I do, would y'all just let me do a little bragging? First of all, let me say welcome. We love you. Welcome to all of our guests. We love you very, very much. I have somebody here that I shared her baby bed. Did any of y'all share anybody's baby bed? Y'all may be seated. I'm going to get you back up in just a minute. Well, Suzanne, Robin Suzanne Powell, bass singer, would you stand? This is the first time. This is my first cousin, but we were raised like sisters. Would y'all give her a hand? Robin Suzanne Powell, bass singer, just retired from 37 years of public school teaching. Can y'all give her a hand? That's just a wow. And welcome, Sister Smith. I'm impressed by you. I really am. I see myself when I grow up being you. And that little sweetheart on that front row with those polka dots on, Christine Roth, would you please stand? I'm going to be her Bible bearer. I'm going to, while she's preaching, I'm going to carry her Bible. We're going to do this again. We're going to duplicate this pattern. Sister Cobbs, would you please come forward? I want to say thank you to Sister Bernard. You're an amazing lady. Thank you, Sister Cassie. Thank you, everybody. And I want to say thank you for opening your hearts. Because if you didn't open your hearts and you didn't come here with a mind to love the Lord, you wouldn't even have a desire to even come around us. But because that you love God and you do want to be rooted, that's why you're here. Sister Cobbs, I told her she was the cutest thing ever, y'all. She's nervous wreck about me doing this. She says, do you need my bio? I said, oh, no. I said, I've got it. I said, don't worry. I said, it won't read. It won't sound exactly like yours. I said, because I'm from Louisiana, and we just don't do that. Just exactly like that. It's like, if I said, I started to read, I said, oh, my Lord. She's amazing. But this is International Evangelist Cobb. Can I get a drum roll? Woo! Hey! And did you see that drummer? Yeah. That drummer right there, that bass part, that guitar player, and that young man, that middle-aged man right there. He's not so young anymore, y'all. He was young. He got him a little age on him now. Two kids will do it to you. Yeah, I want to tell you, they're good at their, would y'all give them a hand? They're good at, they're good, they're great, they're awesome, woo! They put a dance in my step, woo-hoo, I love it. But you know what I love about them? I love their spirits. They are the most wonderful gentlemen and godly men, and I appreciate their faithfulness. Now back to Sister Cobbs. I told you Sister Cobbs would be a little bit different. I said, but don't worry about it. We're going to get this done. Because you got a word. You got a word. She has a Christian education. School teacher. Look at these school teachers. If you're a school teacher, raise your hand. Yeah, look at y'all, educators. Oh, my goodness. Thank you. Thank you. She received her degree. And she also physical education. From the University of London. Look at there. Woo! We are impressed. Yes. And she has taught in schools in England, Canada, and the United States. And I want to say thank you for coming to the United States. She currently lives in Cincinnati, Ohio, attends the church in Aurora, Indiana, where her pastor's wife is here, Sister Smith, and has served many, how many can say many ministries? How many of y'all know about them many, many ministries? I have a feeling she's probably also cleaned out a few commodes and toilets too. Evangelist Cobbs also served as the national and international level at conference speakers. This is what I love about it. And she's married to Dr. Marcus Cobb, MD. So she's got a man in her life. Yeah. Yes, she's got a man in her life that can take care of her. Yeah, came to the country, came to the United States and got a man. That's how she got Cobb. She's Cobb because of that. I can promise she didn't get that over in London. No, that's ours. But what I love about it is that they minister together all abroad. They do all ministries together as well. And if I know she ministers to him and he ministers to her, and they minister together as well. And I want to tell her thank you. And I cannot wait to hear you minister. And we are ready. We are ready. And do you feel like she's ready? Can y'all stand on your feet? And can you love the Lord with all of your heart, soul, and mind? And get ready to open big, big. And say, God, whatever you've got for me, I want it. I want it, Jesus.
Wow. David said, and the King of Glory shall come in. He said, who is this King of Glory? He said, he's the Lord, strong and mighty. He's the Lord, mighty in battle. David says, lift up your heads, O ye gates. Be ye, lift them up, ye everlasting door. And the King of Glory shall come in. He said, who is this King of Glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of Glory. Do you know my Jesus? Do you know my Jesus? None can be compared to him. None. He has no opposite. Some people thought the devil was his opposite. No. He created the devil. And he's got him on a chain. And it's almost over, church. The month of March, you've forgotten what it's all about. The month of March is after the name after the goddess, the god Mars, war. Some of you have had some attack. You're so distracted by the attack that you have not seen the greater anointing that is here. Greater anointing. Wow. I'm going to have you sit down for just a little while. We're going to read some word tonight. Sister Ginger, you did fabulous today. My assignment was not like yours. When the Lord, in fact, after the service, the Lord had spoken to me. When I left Cincinnati, Ohio, I really had what I was going to speak about. But when I went back to my room, the Lord says, uh-uh. I didn't bring you here to make them feel good. He said, for change, there has to sometime be surgery. And I rather obey Jesus. And I said, Lord, the worst they can do is never to bring me back. So that's but I first must do the right and proper thing. I want to thank Sister Hustlich. I love your shoes. Sister, I thought the prettiest shoes were in London. I don't know where you get your shoes from, but they rock. Sister Bernard, it's an absolute privilege to see you again. You might not remember this, but years ago, wow. My first time to Texas to do a ladies' conference was in was in Austin. It was Austin, right? It was in Austin, Texas. And we sat together on the platform, and you began to pray for me. You might not remember, but the Lord remembered. I want to thank you. Thank your mother. Without a mom, you wouldn't be here. Wow. Wow. And what a committee. My Lord. What a committee. Really. I also thank my pastor's wife, Sister Smith from, I always think, where am I from? Aurora, Indiana. I'll explain to you. I actually live in Cincinnati. Well, I sort of live there because I'm not there very much. But when I am there, and I go to church in Aurora, Indiana. And that's quite a thing. And I'm married to a wonderful man. And he's not here, but I give God thanks that he works so I could travel. Sister Scoggins, listen. I have to tell you this. There's no clock, so we don't have any time. Listen. I was in Canada, and the Canadian government was going through my passport, and they said, how come you can travel like this? I thought, God, what do I say? I said, I'm married to a doctor. They said, okay, go on through. So, yes, I want to explain to you, most of you know this. I have had a unique life. I am first generation Pentecostal. That's it. I was born, please listen to this, I was born as a baby in the island of Jamaica, but don't come and ask me many questions about Jamaica because I haven't been there for years, okay? Okay, my mother is Jamaican by birth, and then I went to England as a child. I am a British citizen. Yes, I cried when the Queen died. She was a unique woman. When I came into the Apostolic Church in London, England, and if you support missionaries, I want to thank you. I'm a product of missions. I'm a product of missions. Yes, Mervyn Miller, an Irishman, married a woman from Arkansas, and they came to London. I was going to school of 1,900 girls, and the bully of the school invited me to her apostolic church. I was so, yes. And I was so afraid, I went. I was deeply involved in sports. And I was going to go to the Olympics. So it was in the prime. I was a gymnast. I was a trampolinist. In fact, I was the games captain of the entire school. Why I'm telling you this, when I came to the church, the missionary told me I had to give up sports. And it really was a challenge because of the garments we wear. I remember the Jamaican High Commissioner, which are people assigning countries. Like there's a commissioner the American Embassy in London is unbelievably big. It's beautiful. And so he told me that I was a fool to give up sports. I remember weeping and, you know, I thought, have I done the right thing? But there's an old song that says, I'm not sorry. I answered the gospel call. Jesus took my heavy load, and now I'm on the glory road. And I'm not sorry. I'm not sorry. I'm going to speak to you out of my heart tonight. Sister Nicole is going to help me read. Sister Nicole, I think, okay, you're going to do it from there? Oh, it's up to you. Come on up. If I've forgotten, oh yes, I want to tell you whose fault it is why I'm here tonight. It's Sister Gina Carruthers and Sister Milligan. They're the ones that threatened. I remember, the first time I came to the, do one of your conferences, Sister Milligan came up to me and said, we were talking, and she, I asked her where she was from. She said, the valley. I said, the valley? And she said, if I invite you, would you come to the valley? It's like, well, if the Lord tells me to come, of course. I don't know where the valley is. The only valley I knew was in Psalms 23. In the valley, he restores. I said, well, if I go to the valley and he restores my soul, that's great. And we've been friends ever since. And of course, you know, Sister Milligan and Sister Carruthers, they're like, well, I can't say salt and pepper, but they're quite a team. So they both have been kind to me over the years, and I truly want to say thank you again. If I've missed anyone out, I was shocked to see Sister Susan. She used to come to our church in Lawrenceburg, Indiana. She lives in Denver, and she is here tonight. And of course, if I didn't say hello to all the people from the valley, they'll never forget me. Forgive me. So all the valley people. You know, living in a country, sometimes you're not aware just how great your country is. I want to talk to you tonight for about a few minutes, because that's what the Lord said. The Lord said, you need to speak to the people in the congregation. I don't know if there's anyone here like me, but I carry a passport with me. It has a seal of the Queen on it. And it says British passport, United Kingdom. Come over here, Nicole. And read, there's a seal of the Queen. Unfortunately, it's going to be a seal of the King next. So, no. I'm still mourning Queen Elizabeth. Yes. I want you to hear this. Now, I've heard the word thrown around, kingdom. You've heard it? Kingdom. I've had the wonderful privilege all my life, except when I've lived in the United States, not to be a part of the United Kingdom, but I've always had allegiance to Britain because I've never given up my citizenship with England. You might ask me why, but that's a long story. But I am here because I'm married to an American and because the Lord wants me here. Because of COVID, about 2 years ago, my green card was up. I've applied for one, and it's already taken them nearly 2 years to even give me a green card. However, in my passport, because I go home, I go back to England quite a lot. There's a stamp here. It's called a visa that allows me in your country. Thank you, Jesus. But I want to tell you something about when you accepted Jesus Christ. You might not know this, but when you accepted him, you became a part of a kingdom. Hear me, you are a part of a kingdom. Now listen to what the earthly kingdom, because I have a passport from England, what it says. Listen to this carefully.
Her Britannic Majesty's Secretary of State requests and requires in the name of Her Majesty all those whom it may concern to allow the bearer to pass freely without let or hindrance and to afford the bearer such assistance and protection as may be necessary.
It's saying, because I belong to under the rulership of Her Majesty, please allow her to come back and forth freely. And in fact, to protect me. To protect me. Just think about that. That's the United Kingdom. And yet my Bible tells me that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, can I tell you something about him? For by him were all things created that are in heaven and earth, whether they be visible, whether it be thrones or dominions. All things were made by him. And without him, there was nothing made. You are not serving a little demigod. You're serving the King of Kings. Come on, do you know my Jesus? There is none like him. David said, thine, O Lord, is the kingdom. Oh, thine, O Lord, is the kingdom. Daniel said, to his kingdom there is no end. If I am so, in fact, when I started to tell you about the sports, when they told me about the standards, what helped me is that when I saw Queen Elizabeth, she was never filled with the Holy Ghost. She was not apostolic. But listen to this. She said, I live for my God and my country. The only time I saw her ever wearing pants was sometimes she would be on a horse. But I thought, if she can dress like that and don't know, have the King of Kings, why shouldn't I imitate? Why shouldn't I be a part of, if I'm a part of God's kingdom? I will walk like him. We must talk like him, because we are an image of the invisible God. Do you realize when you got filled with the Holy Ghost? Do you realize, according to 1 Peter chapter 4? You need a chair to sit down.
1 Peter chapter 4 is back here somewhere. I didn't.
Could you, somebody give her a chair? 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. That was not in my message. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 4 says this. Then when you were filled with the Holy Ghost. I want her to read this. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. I can't. Oh. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. There's 1 Peter and 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. It's the same Peter, but he did a second book. So 2 Peter. Brother Matthew is going to work with me back there. 2 Peter. Okay, you got 2 Peter? Do the King James.
Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust.
Look at what it says. You have become partakers of his divine nature. Do you know what that is? That's his DNA. That's his DNA. You've got God's DNA. Do you understand? Can I just tell you how powerful my own blood is? About 2 months ago, they took my blood out of my arm. And I saw the vial getting fuller and fuller. And what they did was, they took my blood, put it in the machine, spun it to where the plasma separated from the red blood. And they took a needle and injected it back in my knee. And it's healing my knee. How much more the blood of Jesus can cleanse us from all. Don't listen to the devil. He's a lie. You stand up and you say, listen, I'll tell you who my daddy is. I'm a child of the King. His royal blood flows through my veins. You have God's DNA. God's DNA. The Lord's harnessing me. I must deliver what he said. When I lay down in the bed, he said, Jennifer, I could hear an American song in my mind. I thought, this is dangerous. I don't want to have them sing it and somebody film it and see it in London. When I go back, they say, you're a traitor, right? You're a traitor to the crown. But I'm going to obey the Lord, because you really don't know how great a nation you have. The only thing is, politically, even in the church, we're so divided. I love the fact that we're the UPC, united. So I'm just going to read you a couple of scriptures, what united means. So go to Genesis, I believe, chapter 11. Okay, would you read that? Verse, is it 9? 1 through 10? Yeah, just listen to this. This is the first time. Again, listen to me. We need to hear some honest concept. Because women, you're struggling about who you are. It's not about who you are. It's whose you are. Let me say it again. It's whose you are. You know, Prince Charles from a kid. I mean, the guy was told he was going to be king. We were hoping he wasn't going to be king. Seriously. Seriously. And the stuff he did to Diana, we thought he would never be king. But if an earthly man can come through such the garbage and still on the throne, and you look at him, I remember one time they said Queen Elizabeth was lost. Don't ask me how a queen could get lost. She was age 12. She went up to a house, a cottage. She knocked on the door and she said, You do not know who I am, but I am a child of the king. Prince William, when he was little, went to a birthday party, and he knocked over the jello. What we call it? I don't know what you call it. Jelly. And the lady in waiting says, "Pick it up." And he was so angry. They said, when he picked it up, he said, "When I become king, I will have your head chopped off." Sounds like Carruthers, the little girl, your little granddaughter, right? Okay. Right. But let's read the scriptures. I need to stay on. Go ahead.
Genesis chapter 11, verse 1. And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech.
One blood, one race. Everybody say with me, one blood, one race. One blood, one race. Human race. One blood, one race. Can I tell you something? Some things from the world has infiltrated into the church. There's a man called Spurgeon. He was British. He's dead. The church that I used to attend in London was built by Spurgeon, Charles Spurgeon. But Charles Spurgeon died of an early age. Well, he was old, but he really, this is what happened. When the man that came on board about we were from apes, who knows what the guy's name is? What? Darwin. And when he wrote it, the Church of England church began to embrace it. And it hurt Spurgeon so much to see that the church was embracing that there's a prominent race and a lesser race. And his wife said in the interview that he began to get very sick. And he could not fight that in the church. And he literally probably died of a broken heart. Why? Because now with Darwin's theory, it's made the Caucasoid, the Mongoloid, the Negroid, and the Aboriginals. Yes, he took pictures of apes and put the Aborigines, the body of the ape and the face of Aborigines. These are concepts that came in the Church of England church. So I thought I'd give you some background. But my Bible tells me, one race, one blood, one race, one blood. Keep reading.
And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, "Go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. and they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower, which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they began to do.
Stop right there. There's a revelation right here. The people is one. The people is one. Notice what is said. It's powerful. That means they are unified. They are unified. If they're walking this way, they're all walking this way. Not one's walking that way and the other three. I'm talking to people who are in a church. We have been praying for revival a long time. We have got to be more unified. God, we are living in the greatest. I mean, the anointing has so increased. Read on, please.
And now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down, and there confound their language, that they...
Keep going to the end.
They may not understand one another's speech.
He said, they're so united that they're putting their mind to build this tower. And they're going to succeed. Why? Because they were all what? And I'm not talking about United Airlines either. I'm talking about the word united. Being together. You're my brother. You're my sister. Read on, please.
So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth. And from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of all the earth. These are the generations of Shem. Shem was 100 years old and begat Arphaxad 2 years after the flood.
Stop right there. Stop right there. Go to Psalms 133. Notice again, people have asked, where did all the languages came from? They scattered. But one race, one blood. Everyone say one race?
One race.
One blood.
One blood.
One blood.
One race?
One race.
One blood.
There's still one race, but they scattered. Okay, Psalms 133.
Verse 1 through 3.
Right.
Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment poured on the head that round down on the beard, even the beard of Aaron, the first high priest, that came down upon the collar and skirts of his garments, consecrating the whole body. It is like the dew of lofty Mount Hermon and the dew that comes on the hills of Zion, for there the Lord has commanded the blessing, even life forevermore upon the high and the lowly.
You read so absolutely well. Thank you. In our everyday language, this is Psalms 133. There's a version out called the TPT, the Passion Translation. How truly wonderful and delightful it is to see brothers and sisters living together in sweet unity. It is as precious as the sacred scented oil flowing from the head of the high priest Aaron, dripping down upon his beard and running all the way down to the hem of his priestly robes. The harmony can be compared to the dew dripping from Mount Hermon, which flows upon the hills of Zion. Indeed, that is where Yahweh has decreed his blessing will be found, the promise of life forevermore. Unity. Stay with me here. Go to Acts chapter 2, verse 1, please. We're dealing about unity. Everyone say unity.
Unity.
Acts chapter 1.
2. Verse 1.
Please.
And when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all assembled together in one place.
Oh, everybody knows that in here. When the day of Pentecost was still to come, they were on one place. They were in one
accord.
They were in one place. They were in one
accord.
If it was a prayer meeting, they were in one place. They were in
one accord.
They were unified.
Unified.
Come on, everybody. They were
unified.
That's right. They were unified, united. They were. God is saying this to the Texas district. I love this. When I came in here this morning, I said, this reminds me of heaven. And I'll prove it by scriptures. Go to, I believe, Revelation. I think I texted you. Revelation
7.
Chapter 7. You got it? Verse 9?
9 through 12. After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands.
Stop right there. Wow. Read it again, and I'll stop you.
After this I beheld.
After this. Listen to this. We're in the book of Revelation, the last book in the Bible. My Bible tells me that John, the beloved disciple, has been banished to an island called Patmos. The word Patmos means my killing. But even in that testing of being in isolation, I've read it. I've seen a film about it. He was in a prison camp. It was terrible. It was horrible condition. While he was in that camp, not because he was guilty, but because of the name of Jesus. And it was during that time of a very deep, dark valley that he saw the greatest revelation. Can I look at you some? So we're reading our trials sometimes very wrong. The Bible says of Jesus, he learned obedience by the things he suffered. Do I like to suffer? No. It's very painful. But I'm here to tell you, your suffering will not be like the next person on the pew. God has a plan and a purpose. You must know that he loves you with an everlasting love. He's not sitting in heaven saying, ooh, I'm going to punish them because of this. No, he loves you. You know how much he loved you? Greater love hath no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friend. So John is on the island of Patmos, and the Bible said the heavens were open. He saw into the throne room. Incredible revelation. Yet he had pain in his body, but he fought it. And when he saw it, he saw the end. There's some from every nation will be here. Think about it. United. United. One blood, one race. I've been in your country now for about, I will be married this August, 35 years. And there's never a year that I have not gone back to London. But I just want you to tell your country, the Lord has blessed me to fly from the East Coast to the West Coast, to the South, to the North. I've been to many of your states. And I have sat in the airplane. And I've looked at the Grand Canyon. And I said, my God, does these American people know how beautiful their country is? I stood in San Francisco. I've looked over the bay. And I think, my God, how great thou art. I went to the redwood forest, and when I looked at the trees 100 feet tall and trunk that you could not even hug, and I thought, does these American people know who they are? But I tell you something, during COVID and during your elections, I have seen a problem in your country that's killing your country. I'm not an American, so I want you to get this straight. I'm not political. I can't vote. I can't do anything. I am not for, but we can be so divided politically. I was in England when one of your presidents was in, and the British people said this. Nobody liked the president. Again, I'm not, this is not political, but you need to understand what I'm saying, church. God is not, we're not waiting on God. He's waiting on us. He really is. He really is. Again, I'm trying to show you how powerful unity is. How unity is. I'm also want to tell you that the Bible says there's power in your tongue. There's a prayer I pray because it's from Psalms. David said, Lord, put a seal upon my lips. That word seal in the original text was God put a fortress upon my lips. So when I read that, I began to pray, God, be the gatekeeper of my lips. Because I've heard Christians speak things. I don't know who they're emanating, but they're certainly not the king. When I go to England, I take Uber because I do not drive in England. Never, I don't like driving on the opposite side of the road. And when I get in the Uber, this is the first thing they say, Oi, are you from America? I said, no, I'm British just like you. Well, you don't sound like us anymore. Yeah, you sound like an American. And what were they saying? My speech. I'm Holy Ghost filled, but I go to the grocery store and say, get out of my way. I'm outside, I'm at work. I say, you come near me. Come on, you can do that. I'm telling you, and God saying, Gabriel, I thought they were in church singing, but they sure ain't acting like me, right? Or I'll give you a piece of my mind. Also, I realized, Jesus said, out of the abundance of the... You know, the other day, I got upset with my husband. And the Holy Ghost checked me. Sometimes I say, Lord, why is it I always have to repent and he doesn't? I said, God, am I so bad? It was his fault, Lord. And I could see the Lord in heaven just laughing, you know. But, you know, and I said, God, search me. Because God, if I became so angry at something that does not justify, something is wrong. So you know what I started to pray? Be the gatekeeper of my heart. Because Jeremiah 17 tells me this, that my heart is desperately wicked, morally sick. Who can know it? He said, I, the Lord, try the heart. I'm speaking very... in love to you tonight. Because there is women, you are armed and dangerous. But you can't be armed and dangerous with a sword that's gonna slice people up. If you're always sour faced, who would want your God? I saw a little old woman, her husband died in COVID. I'm talking about the queen. And she's sitting there in Westminster Abbey all by herself. And I'm crying because I thought, my God, she's not even Holy Ghost filled. She's still being the queen and, oh, keep the stiff upper lip. Come on, yeah, British. I said, my God, if she can do it, so can I. You know why so can I? Because the Bible tells me when we spoke in tongues, Christ in us, the hope of glory. Today I was wearing a kilt. It was tartan. It was sort of kilt. There was all patterns of from Scotland. And a lady asked me, she said, I love these. I said, yeah, it's Scottish. And I bought it in London. See, again, even what I wear can imitate the country of the person. Do you see what I'm saying? Ladies, come on. We're in the last days. And I want us in South Texas tonight, I want us to do something that God wants you to do. The church cannot be divided, even with politics. Politics does not belong in the church. Whenever I go back to England, they'll talk to me, "You're president." I said, "Wait a minute." I tell my friends, "Don't you dare say it." I said, "I didn't vote them in." But you know what? I've traveled and I've seen Americans at dinner just at war with one another, and it's in the church. Your country, I believe, I've been to 40 countries in the world. I've lived in 4 countries. And I've told you, there's none like this United States. Do you realize that you send out more missionaries than any other country in the world? Do you realize that you're the only country that have "In God We Trust" on their money? This is a beautiful country. There is no want for food here. You've got more hamburger joints than any country that I've ever been to. I mean, you go down the street and churches, my Lord, in New York, every 2 minutes there's a church. I want us to do something tonight, and this is what the Lord has asked. We're going to sing a song. Sister Yancey, would you come up? And I want it to be your prayer. I'm not a singer. She's going to help me. And it's a prayer. And you say, "Sister Cobb, I'm not an American," but does everybody live in America? Raise your hand. I want everyone that lives in America, not Texas. Just, yeah, there's... But we're going to stand, and as you sing this, seriously, I want this to be your prayer, because if you leave this conference unified, one nation, under God, indivisible, right, with liberty and justice for all, men have given their lives for this country. I am not an American. But if you only knew that God has smiled on your nation, but the church has got to become unified. No demon in hell can destroy the spirit of unity. God is wanting the churches to be unified. I want us to sing this song. It's a prayer.
God bless America.
Come on, let's sing.
Land that I love, stand beside her.
Let it be your prayer.
And
we need a revival in the nation. Come on.
From the mountains,
sing it, yes,
to the prairies,
to
the oceans, white with foam. God bless America.
Come on,
my home.
Come on, we gotta pray for this nation, apostolic. Come on.
God bless America.
Come on.
My home, sweet home.
We're gonna sing it again. And I want our voices, let it be from our heart. Too many children dying in our schools. The church has got to pray. No, I'm telling you, I'm not here to preach about your nation. But do you realize there's no perfect country? But you are blessed. You are blessed. You not only live in here, you belong to a God that's saying if you will band together in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I want you to look, just touch somebody. Not, they don't have to be beside you, and we're going to sing it again. Because let it be a prayer from your heart. Today I thought, Lord, you're going to have me have them sing this song? Yeah, I've never vowed allegiance to the flag, but I've never been criminal either. I did not know how strongly you felt about your flag until one day in a church that I was attending. We were cleaning the church. Honestly, you don't understand. I grew up in a country where we only pledge allegiance to the queen. Now it's going to be allegiance to the king. And I took the flag out of that post. I thought, it's better on the floor. I thought I killed somebody. Seriously, I did not know out of sheer ignorance. But you know what? I've watched over these 35 years that more Americans complain about their country. And you don't realize what you have. You have a freedom of religion. The church has got to stop praying. We're at the door. Jesus is at the door. The angels are getting ready. Their royal robes are being prepared. It's gonna get worse. We've got to bind together for the cause of Christ. Women in Texas, it don't matter what color the person is. The Bible says that we are rooted and grounded in love. It doesn't matter if they speak Russian, Spanish, Portuguese. There's still one blood, one nation under God. There's no lesser than in the kingdom. One thing you must know, the king cannot be bribed. Else he ceased to be holy. And it's holiness. God wants to descend tonight. I want you to go. If God tells you to go and pray for someone, I know this is unethical, but I'm telling you, God is drawing us to holiness. See, we cry always about our pain. Would you begin to now reach out to somebody else? It doesn't matter whether they're pink, purple, green, or whatever. They are one blood, one life, one God. Above all, in all, he's waiting for unity. Can you love your brother? We must be rooted and grounded in love. How do I do? But Sister Cobb, you don't know what they did to me. Let me tell you this. By this shall all men know you are my disciples. If you have love. The church is dying because of unforgiveness. Ladies, you are powerful. God brought you here for birth. Some of you are wanting your victory. Your victory is in the unified body. If everybody starts worshiping, and let me tell you, for it to be worship, there has to be four elements. Number one, focus. You can't be thinking, I wish she would shut up and just... No, that's not focus. Or, wait a minute, my son, they did this. No, that's not focusing. You have to focus on him. He said, but I struggle with focusing. Focus on the Bible verse. Focus. It takes time and energy to focus. And here's the thing that is key to worship. You cannot worship God above your knowledge of Him. That's why we need to do in the Word. The bigger you know about Him, it's the greater your worship becomes. Oh, yes. John, when he saw into heaven, he saw the 24 elders. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was, which is, and which is to come, the great eternal God. Worship! My Bible told me in John 4 that God is not looking for singers. He's not looking for preachers. He's looking for worshipers. If you're sick and you worship, I tell you what worship also does. It takes you from the outer court of the tabernacle and puts you in the Holy of Holies. Ah, you're in the throne room. Ah, no demon can touch you in the throne room. Ah, and the King of Glory. David said, lift up your heads, O gates. He said, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from God. David said, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Oh, my goodness. Oh, one time he said, they came upon me to eat up my flesh, but they stumbled and fell. He said, though a host should encamp against me, yet my heart will not fear. Though war should rise up against, in this will I be calm. In this will I be, not that you're in America, not that I grew up in England, in this will I be confident. He's coming soon. He's coming first. He's at the door. Sister, I will bet $100 to anybody in this service if they tell me one country that's happy with their leadership. I was in England. I went into a bank just a month ago to pay into my son's account. He was living in England, and they told me, we do not take money anymore in this bank. I said, what? I said, Barclays. Honestly, they were looking at me. And they said to me, no. I said, well, how can I give him this money? You have to do a bank transfer. I went across the road to a chicken wing place, told my girlfriend I was going to treat her. And they said, you can't buy anything in here unless you have a credit card. Cashless. Do you know there is Amazon stores in England now? You can walk in, nobody's in the store. And you go pick up all your stuff and walk out. And the computers check you, and it's closer than we think. Church, the anointing has increased. If you want Him tonight, anything you want, you've just got to break through your thinking. You got to push through. The woman of the issue of blood, she said, if I but touch the hem of His garment. Got to press your way through. Where are you going? To the King. I got to get to Jesus. Sing again. Would you bow your heads?
God bless America.
Land that I love.
Land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night.
God, let this be your prayer, God.
God bless America. Since my soul.
incense my soul.
Incense my soul.
Come on, worship of him.
My Savior God to thee.
Come on, you want more than a touch. You got to break through yourself. Come on. The anointing has increased. He's saying, whosoever will. He's great, he's mighty.
Then sings my soul.
How great thou art.
How great thou art. How great thou art.
To his kingdom there is no end. Come on, he's in the house. It's a breakthrough tonight. Come on, some from every nation, kindred and tongue. Come on.
My soul, my Savior God to me.
It's a love affair. Come on. Nobody has to lay a hands on us. If you don't have the Holy Ghost, there's an anointing in the place tonight. Let me tell you, the Apostle Paul went to Athens. He found an inscription to the unknown God. And he took 20 minutes telling them that the God he serves is none like any other God. And these people had a revival. They did not know the true God, but when they were introduced, they were so hungry. God says, where is my passion in the church? I gotta be passionate for him. I do the pressing, Paul says. Forgetting the things that are behind, I press. I press. Come on, open your mouth, let the Holy, come on. For out of your belly shall flow rivers. That's it, come on, praise him, that's it, come on. Come on, let it spring up, oh well. Open your mouth, you gotta open your mouth. Let the praises of God be in their mouth, a two-edged sword. I don't want to touch. I want to be changed. Press. That's it. Come on. That's it. Come on. Makoshonto manta. Ikiyondo makoshonto. some from every nation. Yes, come on, come on, come on, out of your belly, out of your belly, out of your belly, bring healing, open up your mouth, Shayando, come on. That's it, that's it, that's it. Press, I press. Maya. Yes, there's more. Don't be satisfied. Go, go. Come on, don't be satisfied. God is in the house. I press. Maya Hosoto. From the back of the hall, come on, begin to lay hands on one another. Some from every kindred and race will be. Yes, come on, press. That's it, come on, come on. Pray for one another, come on. Come on. That's it. Come on. You're taking time. Come on, press. That's it, mama. Press. Press. Jesus is in the house. That's it, come on. Come on, that's it, mama, come on. Come on. God is in the house. There's a holy presence in the house. Yes, unified.